Thank you. tongue, open your mouth and begin to speak. Malegede bashande masuka doga, rakada boshende masuka, rekada bashinda masuka doge, rege bashanda masuka, leke bosa, bread of heaven, Father, fill us till we want no more masheka basura, rege bosuke deke deke bashanda bosha, lika baseke. Let them assume it again. I bring our unusual strength and grace from this Ramashega, from this altar in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord.
Yeah.
more than any other time. He said the love of many are wasting cold. Say, Lord, help me. Many are getting discouraged. Some are getting confused. He said, reach out to me and ask me to help you. You need me more than ever before. More than you needed me yesterday. Hey, yes, Lord. Father, reach out to your people. Reach out to your people, Lord. Reach out to your children and encourage them, Lord. Hey, Yaboshika. Reach out to them, oh God. Someone's heart is already broken in pieces. Some are discouraged, some are confused. Some cannot explain what is going on anymore. Lord, reach out to them, oh God. It is too late for us to give up. It's too late for you to give up. Ask him for grace. Say, Lord, I need grace. Lord, I need grace. Lord, I need grace. We are getting closer to the end of the race. And it looks like it's getting a little bit tougher. A little bit more discouraging than ever. But the Lord said, I will strengthen you. I will encourage you. I will strengthen you. I will encourage you. With my right hand of righteousness, I will fight every battle. I will stand on your behalf. And I will shut up the mouth of the devil. In the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. We bless you, Holy Ghost. Oh my God. We give you praise. We give you praise. Father, this same unction, let it linger, oh God. For the more than what we have received now, Lord, let it linger. Even in our sleep. Father, hunger for holiness. Hunger for righteousness. Hunger to love you. Hunger to please you. Hunger to serve you. Hunger to walk closer to you, oh God. Hunger to know you more. Hunger to love you more. Strength like never before, oh God. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Blessed be your name, oh God. Father, we give you thanks. We bless you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, sweet Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Wherever you are, if you are kneeling down, just rise up in strength. May the Lord Almighty encourage you as they rise in strength. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, move on with us. Father, move on with us. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hey, Amashokadana. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. I appreciate every one of you. Those of you watching online, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. There is no distance in prayer. His name is Emmanuel. That means he can be at everywhere, at any time, and at every time. Praise the Lord. That means you have not missed anything. You have not missed anything. He's the same God. Yesterday, today, and forever. Nobody is like him. And nobody will ever be like him. You know, this morning, the Lord gave us a word that is titled, A Call for Holiness. Those watching us online, please bear with us. You know, sometimes we are not in control of the internet, what the internet is doing. It looks like today the internet has as we are trusting God that this will soon be over, we are really trusting God that this will soon be over. I know a lot of you have the hunger to come to church. You have the hunger. You have the hunger. It's not the same watching online and being here live. It's not the same. I understand. But the Lord knows often. He knows that today will come. He knows that a day like this, when everybody will be asked to stay home, he will come. So I believe the Lord already made a way of escape. If you didn't get anything, maybe the praise and worship, the message, it didn't come to you very well, after the service, we will upload it. We will try and upload it on YouTube so you'll be able to watch. God bless you. You will never be left behind in the name of Jesus. Your blessing will locate you wherever you are. No matter the time you see this message, if you are seeing it now, glory be to God. If you see it later, I'm going to tell you something, you have not missed anything. We serve the God that is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That never changed, never fell. Actually, he gets better. That means the more you watch the video, the better the blessing, and the better the impact, the better the revelations in the name of Jesus. Even me, when I'm done preaching, as I'm going home, I'm watching the message. And I watch it 3, 4 times through the week, and I'm the one that preaches the message. And the more I listen to it, the more I get more and more revelation about what the Lord is speaking about. Praise the Lord. So by the grace of God today, I think the Lord have already begun well with us. So the message today, now I know why that he gave us this message. You know, I had a different message in time that I titled, Be Still and Know That I'm God. And for some reason, he changed the sermon topic to a call for holiness. And I'm believing that God is doing that for a reason. With the way he moved this morning, showing why. He wants us to come closer. I did not liaise with the choir. They didn't know what my message is today. But it's, you see that the hand of God is already moving. It's moving. And the Lord, I love that song that says, Lord, whatever you are doing in this season, don't do it without me. Don't do it, whatever the Lord is doing in this season. The miracles he's doing in this season, the breakthrough he's doing in this season, the Lord Almighty will not leave you behind. You will be a partaker of God's blessing in the name of Jesus. But the Lord wants to draw our attention in a topic that we don't really hear too much from the podium. We don't hear that too much from the pulpit. All we hear now is messages of, prosperity, which is awesome. I love prosperity a lot. Because the Bible makes it clear in the book of Genesis 1, he said we should do what? We should be fruitful and multiply. Subdue the earth, be in charge. So prosperity is wonderful. At the same time, a balanced theology is the best. We need to balance it out. It's not always about kill my enemy. I pray that prayer a lot of time. I think I'm professional on that one. But I kill them. Holy Ghost, die. Praise the Lord. But there are some people that actually need to die. I'm sorry. Heaven is not for everybody. Yes, right. If they will not let me rest and I've tried there and they don't listen, that means it's time for them to hear me. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But at the same time, if we preach Pembe and limousine, what do they call it? Jet, helicopter, private jet, personal flight, you can stay in a whole big flight all by yourself and pay for all the seats. Without holiness, they are all rubbish. They are nonsense. Because we, as believers on earth, we are just pregnant. We are just here on a journey. We are just passing through. Praise the Lord. And the only sermon that will take us where we are going is the sermon of holiness. I know prosperity is awesome. Anointing without prosperity, anointing without money is annoyance. Praise the Lord. But at the same time, money without anointing, without holiness, leads you to hellfire.
Which one is better? Be annoyance is better than going to hell.
Praise the Lord. But the Lord Almighty wants us to prosper in all round. That's why the Bible says in 3 John 2, 3 verse 2, he said, people which are above all things that thou mayest to what? Prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospereth. The Lord wants us to have a balanced life. 3 John 2 said, beloved, I wish above all things, above everything, that what thou mayest prosper and be in good health. So it's the Lord wants us to have a balanced life. Praise the Lord. I pray that you may enjoy good health, number one, and that all may go well with you, number two. All may go well. Fruitfulness, family, finances, everything may go well. Number three, even as your soul is getting along well, that means none of them need to be missing. If one of them is missing, there is an error somewhere that needs to be corrected. That means holiness is as important, actually more important than physical wealth. Praise the Lord. Lazarus died and the rich man died. Praise the Lord. Lazarus tried himself in heaven and the rich man found himself in hell. The same Lazarus that begged at the gate of the rich man. The same Lazarus that had saw that doors were leaking became the one the rich man that was in hell was reaching out to go and locate his family members and tell them what's up. Praise the Lord. So does that show you how important that we need to be balanced? We need to be balanced. That is what the Lord is looking for as we, because the Lord said we can have as much money as we need on earth. I was watching the burial of that guy that died in Nigeria. They call him one of the big man there that died. When they buried him, I was looking to see if they will add dollar, pound, everything, and naira in every denomination inside. They didn't even bury him in a casket. They wrapped him with a white cloth and put him inside that shallow grave as if he was nothing. But he's the man that have the most biggest authority in Nigeria. When it comes to that, and also Rock, their government house in Nigeria. But see how he was buried with nothing. I was looking to see him, I couldn't even see his hand. Everything was wrapped up. So we came with nothing, we go with nothing. Except our soul that goes back to God. And the only thing that will cause your soul to go back to God is the life you lead here. How you live your life here on earth. So no matter what we are doing, no matter, that's why you don't need to do anything that we aim you hell instead of heaven. Whatever it is, it's nothing. In my own part of, in Igbo land, when somebody died, they bury the person as if some king will die. They will bury them with real life human being. Oh yeah. I don't know if they still do it now. But they buried them with a real life human being. That real life human being will not still be able to help them to heaven. There is nothing like purgatory. That real life human being actually will not, I don't know, they say, oh, so that person is a king that died. So they still need him to have all his need. A person that is already dead. The Bible is appointed unto man to die once, and what follows is judgment. So once that person closes their eyes, it's over. It's over. It's over. One man died in our area and they buried him. The children, they had money. They buried him with all kinds of gold. My God. At night, armed robbers came and pulled his miserable body from the grave and took all the gold and left him there. Praise the Lord. Because they saw, you know, they were showing off. Oh, all the gold and all the silver. Put it there, put it there. This one win. I will not wait for it to defrost inside the grave. I'm going to go there. They went at night and they put the grave up and collected it and just left his casket out in the air. So that shows that nothing. When we are going with nothing. The only thing that you are going with is your spirit. That's what is going back to God. Dust goes back to dust. So we are nothing but that dust. It's only the breath of God that goes back to him. The Bible in Genesis 1 said that the Lord made man out of clay. And after he molded the clay was nothing. The clay could not move until he breathed. And you get home, read Genesis 1. In his nostrils. And he became a living thing. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So what matters actually in life is your soul. Not your body. It's not the body. The body is important. You are still alive. But once you close your eyes in death, what matters most is where is the soul going? Because there is life after death. Want me to explain? There is life after death. Because we don't, our life doesn't end here. Praise the Lord. I don't know if you guys are hearing me. There, our life doesn't end here. There is life after death. When we close our eyes in life, we open it somewhere. It's either you continue your life in heaven. Let me say so we can, so that maybe the pastors can pray and pull me out of purgatory and take me to heaven. There's nothing like that. You die, you die. That's why we need to watch how we live our life here on earth. Our hunger should be God at all times. How do I please my maker? How do I make it to heaven? Whether coronavirus or no coronavirus, whether the door opens or the door don't open, it doesn't matter. How do I nurture my spirit? How do I nurture my soul? How do I stay pure for the Lord? He said he's coming back for a church without spot or blemish. A church without spot or wrinkle. When the Lord is talking about a church, he's not talking about the physical beauty. He's talking about me and you. Beloved, 1 minute pleasure is nothing compared to eternity in hellfire. Imagine how it feels to put your hand on a stove by mistake. Even if stove is high level, just ordinary, like when you warm your food on the microwave, you bring it out, you already covered it with like cellophane. Open the, just that little vapor that comes out of that plate that came from the microwave. If you mistakenly touches you, it might hurt you for a couple of days. So imagine fire. Raw fire. Imagine how it feels. Then imagine heaven. When I preached the sermon that I titled Our Home, Heaven on Earth, I made a very clear description of what heaven looked like. Laid with God. Beautiful place for you to go to. If you can do everything on this earth, just for you to live an ordinary mansion that is made by man, man made it. You do everything to drive the best car on earth. That one accident is a disaster. Praise the Lord. So, what will it cost you for your eternity? When God is saying, you know, we actually work hard for what we have on earth. You work hard to pay that mortgage every month. A lot of people have not been to work for like a month or two. You know what is killing them? It's not the virus. It's how will I pay this mortgage? How will I pay? Here in America, we live life of borrowers. The car you drive, it's on lease. Some are on loan. You have started finished paying my scholarship. 5 years of paying every single month for car notes. I'm not joking. You have a house here, 30 years of mortgage.
Not be small money. When I call myself, tell her, you know, every month, this is how much I pay in my rent. And when they start bugging me, so I start, you know, bring everybody their rights. Then I pay this amount for mortgage. This one for my car note. This one for my daughter that is in college. College here is not easy. So if you have not started saving for your children, start saving for them now. Praise the Lord. You know, it's not easy. When you check out those things, if you can work hard to see your children through college, work hard to live in a mansion, what happens to eternity? The mansion that is, that the builder itself is God. The man, you don't have, you're not paying nothing for the mansion. Except your relationship with Christ now. That's your payment for that mansion. It's the relationship you have with God. Not what my pastor told me. It's not. But the your personal relationship with God. The Lord is calling us to holiness and righteousness. That is the key. That's all he's looking for. He's not asking you for your gold. He's not asking you for silver. He's not asking you to pay tithe. Not asking you to give offering. It's your choice. It's not by force. You don't have to. It's your choice. Paying your tithe and giving your offering does not guarantee heaven. It doesn't. It only guarantees you your health, your earthly prosperity. Because whatever a man soweth, he will reap. That's the guarantee. But does not guarantee that you will make heaven. It doesn't give you the power, the dunamis to pray. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. And heaven will not come unless if we live a holy life. And that's where we end. It's not about how you begin. It's the end of a thing that matters. Praise the name of the Lord. There's an unusual grace and power on this altar today. And the Lord is speaking to us. It's time for the church to wake up. It's time for it is not time for us to give up. Beloved, even if you get mad at God, I don't have a job. All this and that. You complain about everything. When you are done, you serve him. It does not stop him from being God. It does not stop heaven and earth, heaven and hell from being real. So God cares about how you feel. But how you feel does not determine where you go when the trumpet will sound. I don't know if I'm speaking to somebody this morning. No matter how you feel, some of us, our cry is, God, why me? Why is things going this way? Why do I have to do this and do that? Why do I have to labor and nothing to show for it? All we do is lament from now to tomorrow. But you don't ask God, say, why? Why are you not the one in the mortuary? Why are you not the one in the hospital with coronavirus? Why are you not the one laid in the hospital with cancer? Don't ask God all those things. So what am I trying to say? No matter how we complain, no matter how some of us get mad at God, some get themselves drunk in drug addiction, alcoholism, because they go, God is not fair. I used to go to church. It's not a testimony. I used to love God. It's not, I used to live right. It's not a testimony. I've had people confession. I used to be in the choir. I stopped going to church. I don't think that prayer is right. Church folks are not good people. The worst people are in the church. It will concern me. I'm not God. Unless if you are going to church to serve people. If your work for heaven, if it's for people, that means you are going with them to hell. Praise the Lord. But may that not be our portion in the name of Jesus. The grace to serve God right. The God, the Lord Almighty is looking up to us. He will not force himself into you. He will be the one to reach out to him. Praise the Lord. Even if you feel that he has not answered your prayer, because you are the one that says, well, he knows that he already answered you. Maybe the answer that God, he is God that answers all prayer. That's one thing I know. Every prayer you pray to him, he answers. Even if you pray, God, let my enemy die, he already answered you. But he will give you the right answer. Maybe the answer you are looking for is to hear, you know what, last night, Sister Abayo went to bed, she didn't wake up and say, yes, it's my prayer that killed her. That's all you want to hear, but God knows his way. He might decide to say, you know what, Sister Abayo is not going to die. I'm pulling her back to myself. I'm going to use her to rescue you tomorrow. You don't know. You don't know. So when God answers prayer, just rest. When you pray, believe that it's answered. Some are angry at God for nothing because they are not seeing beyond the physical. All they see is what they want. God, I want this. God, I want that. God, I want that. What if you have a child that is 4 years old? Even 14 years old, and the child said, oh, mommy, give me, that child don't know how to drive home. Say, mommy, you need to give me the key. I want to go to the store. Your car key. Let me go to the store, and if you don't give it to me, I will die. You better die, because I won't give it to you. So that's how God deals with us. Yes, you want the key. Okay. Your request is hard and already answered. And the answer is, I don't want to send you to an early grave. That means you will not get the key. But to you, he didn't answer. Praise the Lord. And then you are angry for nothing. There's a song that we sing in my language. We say, in a barachuhunga, in a werechuhiwe, in a bacharambe, you know what it means? He said, are you going to argue with God? Are you going to cuss God out? Say, when you don't cuss him out, you have to come back and beg him. Because you cannot cuss him out. He's God, your age mate. He's not our age mate. He knows the end from the beginning. He knows what he's doing. And all he's asking you is be holy. That's all I'm looking for. A call for holiness. That is the key for eternal life. The life we live here matters. But the one that we live when we open our eyes is the best, is the one that we live in heaven. And our eyes is closed here. And we open it up on the other side. Which other side? Is it at the right hand or you're going to the left? Where are you going to? That's what matters. A minute of pleasure is nothing compared to eternity of torment in hell. May the Lord Almighty encourage you. May the Lord help us. I'm going to tell you something. End time is here. The end is coming, and it's coming faster than we thought. I know some will say, we've been waiting for this God. You know how old I am now? And he still have not come. This and that and that. Some have a lot to tell God. Why they will not believe whatever you are telling them? Because they feel that God is not coming yet. When you get home, read the book of Matthew 24. Read it from 1 to 8. Praise the Lord. And tell me that everything that you see in there is not already in motion. It's already in motion. Men are being more wicked than they will ever be. Things are happening. Showing that the timing is near. That's why we need to wake up. During the time of Noah, he sounded the alarm severally. But those that believed him entered the ark. And those that say, Amen, will God destroy this beautiful, wonderful, this place that we are doing whatever we want to do? No, he will not. But when their eyes opened, when the storm became peak, and they saw the rain coming non-stop, and they were asking Noah, Noah said, I didn't shut the door. The owner of the door has shut and collected the key. I pray it will not be too late for us to get closer to this God. Hey, his presence is awesome. His glory is marvelous. I want us to get lost in the spirit at all time. Get lost in God's presence at all time. Imagine how it feels like. Just visualizing how glorious it will be on that day. Hey! And that's why when people die, they don't want to come back. But when God opens their eyes to see heaven, oh my God. Nobody sees heaven and wants to come back to earth. To do what? Praise the Lord. But if you say, oh, what of all your children? Don't worry, God will take care of them. You can offer them everything on earth. You cannot be compared to the glory that is in heaven. Praise the Lord. Follow me to the book of Romans 12, 1 to 2.
Romans 12,
1 to 2. I'm going to read Amplified Version. That I appeal to you, therefore, brethren, and I beg you in view of all the mercies of God. And I know the Lord is talking to us, to me and you, to make a decisive decision of your body. Make a decisive decision. Be very conscious about it. Let no man persuade you. Make up your mind on your own. Praise the Lord. Presenting all your members and faculties. Praise the Lord. All your members from head to toe and faculties, including everything that belongs to you on earth. Say, presenting all your members and faculties as a living sacrifice. Holy. There is a call for us to live holy. Holy. Devoted, consecrated, and well pleasing to God, which is your reasonable, rational, intelligent service and spiritual worship. That's all the Lord is looking for. Present yourself to Him. Holy. Praise the Lord. But sometimes it's hard for some people, including me, to live holy. That's why we need God. The Lord created Adam and Eve in the garden, gave them everything. That one thing that He said, do not touch. That's the one that their eyes is on. Among all the fruits in the garden, just one. But that's the first place the devil tempted them. Beloveds, we have more grace now. We have more grace now. Because
Jesus is the Lamb
that has been sacrificed for me and for you. So we don't have any excuse to say Adam and Eve. And so even if Adam and Eve did it, where did Adam and Eve end up? It's because of their act that caused the trouble that we are in today. Praise the Lord. Because that wasn't the main purpose that God created man. He didn't create us to make us suffer on earth. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But sin, unholiness, can change the hand of God. It can change the face of God. It can make God to look away from us. The Bible in Isaiah 59 is very clear. His hand is not too short. His ear is not dull. You start reading from verse 1. He said, but your iniquities have separated you. What is iniquity? Sin, unholiness. Praise the Lord. So that means if we can live right, when we call upon Him, He will answer us. That's why He said in Isaiah chapter 1, if you start reading from verse 18, He said, come now, let us reason together. Saith the Lord. Come, let us reason together. He wants me and you to have a beautiful life. But He's calling us for a life of purity, a life of holiness. Come now, from verse 18 of Isaiah chapter 1. He said, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. He said, if you are willing and obedient, you will eat the best of the land. Praise the Lord. So do you see where holiness is attached to prosperity? Do you see that? You see where holiness and prosperity is linked together. That means for you to prosper, there is a call for you to be holy. The Lord will make ways where there is no way if we can learn to live a holy life. Say, come, let us reason together. Those weak areas, let's talk about it. Those areas where it looks like things are not working, and let's talk about it. Those things you think you cannot do because you don't have strength enough to do them, let's talk about it. Let's reason together. The Lord that we serve is not an irrational God. He's a God that feels what we feel. If you think that land lost in you, you cannot control it, talk to God about it. Reason with him. And I'm going to tell you something. If you can reason with him, you won't even know what happened to that feeling. It will just die until the right time. Praise the name of the Lord. So we need to really, really go back to God. Verse 2 of Romans 12 says, do not be conformed to this world, this age. Don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. Fashion after adapting external superficial custom. But be transformed. Be changed. Be renewed. That's what the Lord is looking for. He's looking for a renewed heart. He's looking for a changed heart. No matter how bad we are, the Lord can change us. He can conform us to his own nature, the way he wants us to be. He wants us to be like him. He wants us to be like him. No matter what the temptation may be, I have decided to follow Jesus. No matter what the trouble may be, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. No matter what it is. No matter what it is. I was watching a clip that somebody sent when one of the president of Khan was beheaded in Nigeria. If that guy had denied Christ, he would have still been alive today. But the devil thought he had done his best. They didn't know that they did the best for him. Apostle Paul says, to me, to live will be for Christ, and to die will be gain. That means even if you can hear me and you are a Muslim, you need to receive Christ before it's too late. Because there is only way to Christ. That man was beheaded by Boko Haram in Nigeria. The evil Islamic movement, they beheaded him. They think that they've done the worst, the best. Themselves. When Judas betrayed Christ, they crucified him. He did all that because the gospel must be fulfilled. That's why Jesus said, if Judas had tarried, if he had waited, he would have still forgiven him. He would have still made it to heaven. So I'm giving you a chance today. Like Christ talked about Judas. If Judas still had a chance of being forgiven, I don't know what you have done that you think God cannot forgive. I don't know where you are that you think God cannot use you. He's God of breakthrough, God of second chance, God of multiple chances if you are still alive. May the Lord keep every one of you at the sound of my voice alive. May he sustain you, may he preserve you. Until the day the trumpet will sound in the name of Jesus. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1. I'm going to read Amplified Version. He said, therefore, since these great promises are ours. He said, beloved, let us clean ourselves from every the Spirit and bring forth consecration to completeness in reverential fear of God. Since we have these great promises, the Lord does not make promises that he cannot keep. He's a covenant-keeping God. I love that song that says, Yahweh, covenant-keeping God. Yahweh, covenant-keeping God. He keeps his promises. Say, look at the beautiful promises I've made to you. Since you can see it, you can perceive it. Say, why not keep yourself holy? Let the fear of God grip you, not the fear of man. When Joseph had the chance to become a millionaire overnight in the land of Egypt, in the house of Potiphar, he said, well, how will I do this evil and sin against my God? It wasn't much about what Potiphar will do to him. It wasn't much about the kind of money he will get. He said, well, how will I do this great evil and sin against this God that has brought me this far? He wasn't looking at his immediate need. He was looking at the eternal, the future that is ahead of him. We need to look at the future that is ahead of us. And the Lord will give us the grace. Amen. King James says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us clean ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. The Lord that we serve is holy. He said, be holy. The Lord that we serve is a perfect God. He wants us to be perfect. But it is not by strength, it is not by power. That's why the grace of God is always available. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 7 says, for God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. For God has not called us unto impurity, but for us to consecrate and dedicate ourselves to uttermost purity, holiness. He has not called us to an unclean life. He has called us to a holy life, a life that the Lord will be proud of. Praise the name of the Lord. My God is an awesome God. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm going to read the book of 1 John 3. I'm not going to read. When you get home, you can read it. 1 John chapter 3 from 2 to 10. I think I already treated. Let me just read a few verses. I know my time is almost up. He said, beloved, now we are the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we. Let me read Amplify, so I don't have to explain too much. He said, beloved, we are even here and now God's children. We are God's children. So it is not yet disclosed, made clear, what we shall be thereafter. Praise the Lord. From the day you said yes to the Lord, you are his child. But what you will become tomorrow is in your hand and in God's hand. What your tomorrow will be is in your hand and in God's hand. The devil, the wicked, the enemies have no right to decide what your future will be. Your future is in your hand. Your future is in the hand of God. So, and everyone who has this hope, resting on him, cleanses, purifies himself, just as he's pure. We need to. So everyone who commits, practices sin, is guilty of lawlessness. I'm not going to keep reading. When you get home, finish it till verse 10. Finish it till verse 10. May the Lord Almighty help us. We are all children of God. We are his dearly, dearly beloved children. He made us like him. When you see me, you see God. When I see you, I see God. Because that's what the Bible says. He said in Genesis 1, come, let us make man in our own image and our own likeness. But the question is, when men see you, are they truly seeing God in your attitude? Are they seeing God in the way you dress, the way you talk, the places you go, the things you do? Praise the name of the Lord. So that's what the Bible is telling us. The Bible says in the book of 1 Peter chapter 1, if you read 14 to 16, 1 Peter 1, 14 to 16, he said, therefore, guide your mind for action. Keep sober in the spirit. Fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Verse 14 says, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the former dust, the former things which were yours in your ignorance. Things that we do, I'm going to tell you, you will not say you have no heart. The holiness is in your heart. At the time of ignorance, God awakes. He behaves like he didn't see what we are doing. But when you have heard, severally, you've heard, you will not say, God, I don't know. You know now I'm talking to you, and I'm talking to myself too. I'm talking to myself too. So as an obedient children, do not be conformed to the former dust, the former things, which you wear in ignorance. He said, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourself, as in all your behavior, not some of your behavior, all, everything that you do. Let us see the appearance of Christ in you. Let us see the light. You know, let people see you and see God. Some people will never read the Bible. The only Bible they will read is you.
The things you see. I have my little baby in the house.
There are things I say, oh, it's a pastor, you just said a bad word. Everything for her is a bad word. She said, Chine, shut up. Oh, pastor just said a bad word. Just, I guess, the mom said, I'm not a bad word, shut up. So for her, it's a bad word. There are things we used to do in ignorance. They're not saying, don't do them anymore.
Don't do them anymore.
The laws of the flesh, the laws of the eyes. You know, it's too enticing. You see, oh my God, my headmates are doing this. And some of your headmates are also in the juvenile hall. Praise the Lord. Are we thinking as I'm thinking? May the Lord Almighty help us. Say, be like the Holy One who called you. And be holy yourself also in all your behavior. Always ask yourself, how will Christ treat this? If Jesus is here, what will be his next move? What will be his reaction? What will he do? I'm telling you, sometimes as human beings, even me as a pastor, I freak out. Something happened to me when I came here during the week. I freak out. I was crying. I said, God, what is this? But at the same time,
is they not my house? Is it your house? It's my house. So it belongs to me. I'm the one that will
guide and protect. I'm the one that will pay the money. So what is your problem? So I have to, you know, sometimes we get off because we are human beings. But if you get off, you are not coming back. You need to ask yourself a question. Am I still in the Lord? Is the Spirit of God still in me? The Spirit of God in you will bring you back. That's why we have the Spirit of God in us. It's like an alarm in our brain to alert. You just said that. You just did this. You know, what example are you showing? If you are freaking out, you are the pastor, what would the church members do? You need to stop it right now. That's what Holy Spirit do to every one of us. There are things that will happen, it's like your heart is beating fast. It will take, that's why Jesus Christ would not live without bringing the Holy Spirit. He did not allow the apostles to operate until they tarried in Jerusalem in the upper room to receive the Spirit of the Counselor, the Comforter. And every one of us, from the day we gave our lives to Jesus, we had it. And it
tells you, no, you cannot tell me you are a believer and you don't know when you sin a lie. When you sin, you know, but you just ignore the Holy Ghost. That's what happens. Because that's what your body, your soul is asking for at that time. You are not listening, but he's speaking. And what I have to tell us is Holy Ghost is not a power. Don't talk too much. When he talks, you don't listen, you quietly, a gentle spirit, walk away. And when you get it right, he will come back. And I pray that we all get it right before it's late. Because nobody knows. Matthew 25, I think verse 13, said that none of us know the day the trumpet will sound. Matthew 25. I believe it's verse 13. Matthew 25. Thank you, Jesus. Matthew 25, verse 14. Says again, I tell you, verse 13 says, verse 13, I'm right. Say, therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. When the trumpet will sound, we don't know the day. So we need to be ready at all times. Serve this God as if, not as if. Serve him knowing that your life depends on it. That is the whole truth and nothing but the truth. You know, this message is a lot. I think I'm going to have to push it for next Sunday so we can go. It's a message I don't want to rush. We're going to take our time. We are, by God's grace, we are coming back to church. As you're coming back to church, you are coming back a new, total, refreshed, revived, amen, renewed, amen, on fire, amen, because the fire have already been ignited today. Amen. Don't allow anybody to cause you heaven. Don't allow anything to cause you heaven. I've been asking myself, God, what of if I was among those that caught corona and they died? Where would I have ended up? That's a question that we need to be asking ourselves. What if you didn't get the chance to hear Sister Jessie today? So you can make a U-turn. What would have been the answer? Like I keep saying, few minutes of pleasure is nothing compared to eternity in hellfire. I'm speaking to us, and the Lord is talking to us this morning. I'm going to continue next Sunday. I'm going to read the book of 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 21. That will be the last one for today. So today's message is called for holiness, part one. Next Sunday we'll continue, but I need to tell you what you need to do. The things we need to do, which I know we all know, but at the same time we need to keep reminding ourselves. I do the same thing. My niece will always say, whenever something is hard, and as I say, auntie, you need to be the one to talk. When I get on the phone, I will speak. If you don't listen, you will listen to me. That's how I am. One way or the other. Tell me, you know what? For this person on the other line, I thought they say she's a pastor. So why is she raising her voice? And sometimes, that I'm a pastor doesn't make me a dust collector. Doesn't make me not a human being. I'm a human being and not my rights. Praise the Lord. But at the same time, whatever we do in life, let's not overdo. Don't go overboard. Don't go overboard. Remember that we are just a sojourner. We are just on a pilgrim. We are just on a pilgrim. I want you to tell yourself as we round up today's message. I'm going to continue next Sunday. I'm going to continue. I'm not going to read that second commission. I'm going to go to next Sunday. Talk to yourself. I want you to stand up wherever you are at home. Anywhere you are hearing me from. Just stand up and just talk to the Lord. I want you to recite to yourself. Say, I am on a journey and I must get to my destination. Hey! I am on a journey. I'm an ambassador on earth. I'm an ambassador. An ambassador of Nigeria to America is not a citizen of America. They must go one day. unless if they decide to deny their Nigerian citizenship. They come here with a diplomatic passport. And when they go with their diplomatic passport, unless if they decide to ignore Nigeria and become Americans. Praise the Lord. There's something applicable to us. There's something that we say in my language, Odije Mola. Praise the Lord. Did you hear what I said? What I said means a visitor, a day may come, you must go. We have not come here to pitch tent and stay forever. The question is when that day comes. When the Lord say your time on earth is up, where are you going to go? Reminding myself too. I'm an ambassador of Christ on earth. I'm on a pilgrimage. And when you're an ambassador, what do? You represent the country that you are serving. And our own country is heaven. That's why when I hear my sister take off, she say our resources is not of this earth. Our resources is in heaven because God is the one that has called us. The unusual storm that goes around the earth that throws men financially out of balance is not qualified enough to throw us out of balance. You can't believe it is yours. Even if everybody cannot pay their rent, your rent will be paid.
Amen.
If you can believe in that heavenly resources. Somebody was telling me one day, you know, people are on lockdown. And some pastors are still asking for tithe and offering. Right here? Because those pastors have understanding that your resources is not an earthly resources. That God always make way. In 1 Kings 19, what's his name? Elijah was running for his life. What did God do? He sent a raven to feed him. When there was famine in the land, the Lord directed Elijah where to go. To the widow of Zarephath. He said, I've already, you know, set somebody up there that will feed you. That widow's home never lacked anything. You know why? Because the resources of heaven does not run dry. So I need you to believe God. Holiness is in everything. Everything, including your finances. Includes, like I said, if you look at that book of Isaiah chapter 1, from 18 and 19 and 20, it talks about how holiness and prosperity is tied together. If you are obedient, we eat the fruit of the land. He said the wealth of the unjust can be transferred into the hand of the just. Cash. What qualifies you to get that wealth is your righteousness. The wealth of the unjust. Transfer to the just. If you are not just, you cannot get it. So that shows you how important it is for us to live holy. How important. My niece is here. You know, we run a business that if you don't have so many amount of business, they don't pay you. Sometimes I have four. Only one. For me to get all that money, I will say no. I'm sorry, she's standing here watching me. And I'm telling you, especially now, in coronavirus, we have too many that are saying no. You have only four business. I think like that. They tell you don't be second. I'm not, it's not enough to end me hellfire. So anytime they say, oh, we're gonna audit you, I'll be free to just give you whatever they want. When you are busy lying your teeth and lying your way through. Oh, one day, I was telling Sister Joy during the week when she tested me, trying to encourage me. I said, one day, every day is for the thief. Didn't I tell you that? But one day is for the owner of the house. That's why holiness is tied to prosperity and your peace of mind. Then in everything that you do, be holy. It's important. It's very, I'm not going to be bold here to say it on the air. Knowing that I also have employees that work under me. So they can hear me. They know I'm not lying. If I'm lying, I won't be saying it all through the air. And I'm going to tell you that I don't get all those extra money others get. I have more money in the account than them that get all those extra money. I don't know how God does it. He does it anyway. So we need to really make up our mind. Either you serve God or you don't serve God. It's either you serve him or you don't serve him. Can we come to that point where we make up our mind? Either you serve God or go back to the world. Enjoy as much as you can because that's all you get. Or you serve God and enjoy on earth and still enjoy in eternity. I was listening to, I think it was Paul Enetche, early this morning. He said something. He said that, exactly what I said before, that there is two life. Like, our life doesn't end here, which is true. I confirm it. There's life after death. When we die, there is life after death. But it depends on where you want to be when that day comes. That's when a lot of people hear that they are dying, they don't have peace. But unfortunately, because they don't know what they're supposed to do, even if they can accept Christ right there, as you are hearing me now, to accept Christ where you are right now. Beloved, the promises that the Lord have made to me is yours also. In the name of Jesus. So if you can hear me, you want to give your life to Christ. There was just a great cloud of glory of God in this sanctuary this morning. I was sitting there. I couldn't hold myself. When I came up here, I couldn't hold myself. God is hungry to have you be a true child of God, a true servant of God. It's not about some people are too much, they are too much committed to the things of this world. They're not thinking about heaven. Let's start thinking about heaven. It's not about whatever we lose on earth. My God, it's not heaven. The best is yet to come. Like the wedding in Galilee. They were all drinking and having fun. The drink ran out. And Jesus touched. The hand of God was laid upon that ceremony. And the wine that came was the best that they have ever had. Beloved, there is a better life after here. Father, even right now, Lord, if you are hearing me, you want to make peace with God, I want to give you the chance to do that. You want to recommit yourself. It doesn't matter what you have done in the past. Yesterday is gone. But right now, we are more in need of God. I'm telling you, I don't know about you, but I'm telling you, I need God more now than I've ever needed him. Because things that causes men to stumble will never cease. Luke chapter 17, verse 1. Things that causes men to stumble will never cease. The trouble on earth is getting bigger and bigger and worse than what it has ever been in the past. Say, Father, help me. Talk to the Lord. Bring me back to you. Bring me back to you. I love that song. Say, you are all I need. Say, Lord, you are all that I need. Journey of life. He makes all things beautiful in his time. Father, do it, Lord, and be glorified. Blessed be your name, O God. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for hanging on with us. We are at the end of the service today. We appreciate you. We love you so much. We love you so much. I know that the Lord loves you more. The Lord will keep you. He will prosper you. He will protect you. The hand of God will rest upon you. You know, we are here in California. We are still on lockdown. So we are trusting God. As soon as they say we can come to church, trust me, you'll be the first person to know. We are keeping up on the news. We don't want to be disobedient. Holiness is in everything, including the law of the land. As long as it does not as long as it does not cause us to sin against God. I'm telling us to be on lockdown. It doesn't make us to sin against God, so we need to be obedient. So as long as they say stay home, we'll stay home. Or we try our best like we are trying. I know some of you couldn't follow the service all the way because of some technical issues. But we are trusting God that it will get better in Jesus' name. And again, we're going to upload it on YouTube. Well, it's already on YouTube. So if you didn't see everything, go on